Hello everyone. On behalf of Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage Intact and the Intact Conservation Institutes, I extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished speaker, Mr. Bijin Bihari Paul, and everyone who has joined us for today's talk in the Conservation Insights 2020 lecture series. I'm Dr. Padma Rohila, Director, ICI Delhi. Now to introduce our speaker, Bijin Bihari Paul hails from a weaver's family born. He was born on 11 February 1955 at Anandapur, West Midnapur in West Bengal. He studied handloom technology course at the Indian Institute of Handloom Technology, Varanasi, and project planning and infrastructure management in Rajasthan University, Jaipur. He taught at the Indian National Institute of Handloom Technology, Varanasi for 3 years and then joined the Weaver Service Center as designer and finally retired as Zonal Director in February 2015 after serving for 40 years. During his service, he was posted in various parts of India such as Varanasi, Jaipur, Agartala, Chennai, Delhi, and had an opportunity to work with the handloom weavers directly for their promotion. After retirement, he was engaged as consultant in the Office of the Development Commissioner for Handlooms, Ministry of Textiles for 3 years. And presently works as a consultant with Taniyara, a Titan group of companies. To name his contributions, he was instrumental to formulate India Handloom brand scheme. He brought 2 collections of exclusive handloom products under Tantavi project. He was deputed to Nepal as handloom expert 2 times under Colombo plan and ITC for development of the handloom sector there. Deputed to Cambodia to establish the Ancient Textile Museum under Mekong Ganga Corporation. And he extended his service to SAARC for craft documentation related workshops in India, Bangladesh and Nepal. He developed 3 handlooms for better productivity with less fatigue to the weavers and brought 2 shade cards for natural dyes and eco-friendly dyes as guidebook for the dyers. He implemented R&D projects on design documentation and loom development, and he's also authored 20 technical articles which were published in many textile journals. He's also associated with many NGOs, institutions like National Institute of Designs, NIFT, Banasthali Vidyapeeth, MIT University, Indian Institute of Crafts and Design, the Tata Trust, Women Weave, etc. for the cause of handlooms. He received the prestigious National Award from the President of India in 1991 for his innovative design of handloom product. Welcome, Mr. Bijin Bihari Paulji, and thank you so much for accepting to give this presentation. The title for the talk today is Materials and Weaves of Some Important Indian Textiles. History of Indian textiles is as old as the history of mankind itself. Artisans were engaged in hand spinning, weaving, and dyeing of cotton textiles during the civilization of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, as per the evidence found in the excavation. The type of raw materials and its quality plays a crucial role in the character of the fabric that comes out. The properties of natural fibers are quite different from the synthetic fibers. Therefore, these fabrics made have better feel, comfort, durability, dyeability, etc. The next important chapter of a fabric depends on its weave. Elementary weaves like plain, twill, satin, etc. form the base of any fabric which is decorated or ornamented with weaves like extra warp, extra weft, etc. Designing is essential to enhance the beauty of the fabric. India has a long tradition of weaving, a wide range of products using cotton, silk, and wool. These products do vary from state to state. And today in this presentation, Mr. Paul will be explaining some of the weaves and materials used in some of the most important textiles in India. Before I invite Mr. Paul, may I please request all of you to put your microphones on the mute. We will be taking the questions right at the end of the presentation. So please do type in those in the chat box. I'll be keeping an eye on them. And also type in your name, organization name, and your email ID in the chat box. Mr. Paul, I now request you to please start your presentation. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you so much, Padmaji. I am very thankful to Intact, in fact, to give me this opportunity to say something about India else. And it is a coincidence that today is 7th of August, is an auspicious day for the handloom and handloom artisans of our country. It was declared as National Handloom Day by our Honorable Prime Minister in 2015 to recognize the contribution made by the artisans for the development of the sector for the history of the country. I'll try to explain some of those important Indian textiles. It's a huge, no? There's a huge, huge archives of Indian textiles. So it's very difficult to say all those things just within an hour time. So whatever I have experienced, what I have learned, what I have seen, what I have worked, I have tried to just pin down and put it in such a form that it is understanding and it is understandable by even the common man. Of course, these links also will help the researchers, the designers, and the connoisseurs of the Indian textiles or the textiles in particular to understand the subject in a better way. Yeah, now so far the history is concerned of Indian textiles, it is almost 5,000 years old. And it is very surprising that when all other countries, mostly all other countries have lost their tradition of hand weaving, India still continues with a beautiful and with a very glorious past maintaining the tradition. And silk also introduced in 1050 BC. We had our Indian tropical tussock. Of course, there was mulberry also, the mistari varieties. Cotton during 445 BC used to be exported to Europe in a big way. Alexander the Great took many beautiful cotton fabrics with him in 327 BC. Greek ambassador Megasthenes mentioned about the muslins with gold and silver, or that is the beginning of jerry work with cotton in flowered garment, that is flowered muslins in 300 BC. And of course, this tradition reached to its height or reached to its peak during the Mughal period. Today, we have got 0.7 million handlooms in our country. And 3.5 million artisans are engaged directly and indirectly through this sector. And we're surprised to know that almost 70% of these artisans are why the tradition is still continuing. I feel it is not only a professional job or the avenue for earning their livelihood, but also it reflects the culture. If you happen to be in northeastern parts of our country, there are 7-8 small states. There, the ladies are not married if they do not know how to weave. So what I feel, why the tradition is still alive and is still going strong and stronger day by day, because it is not only a means of livelihood to the artisans, but also it reflects the culture, the custom and belief of our society. For example, if you happen to be in northeastern state of our country, there the women and the ladies are not married if they do not know how to weave. She has to wear her bridal dress woven by herself. Even after her death, the fabric woven by her will accompany with her body for burial. So when such a strong belief is there, so why not? There's no doubt that it will continue for hundreds and thousands of years. And again, there the men are not allowed to weave. They say if men are men weave, then he will be killed by the wild boar. But that is maybe maybe whatever the belief may be. But that is a strong cultural aspects of this tradition of hand weaving. And another very interesting thing that we mostly use natural fibers, whether it's a cotton or silk or wool or hemp or linen, all are natural fiber cultivated in our country. And you'll also surprise that today even 95% of world's hand-woven fabrics are made in India. So it's such a strong background, I feel personally, that the handloom industry or the hand weaving industry or sector will going to last many, many years to come. Even though there's a lot of problem, there are a lot of competition from the mill-made or the machine-made fabric. So just to understand, the fabrics are made out of yarns, and the yarns made out of natural fibers. The fibers are in two different categories. You know, 200 years back, or rather 150 years back, all were natural fibers. There is no synthetic, there is no man-made fibers throughout the world. So natural fibers again has got three different sources from we get: the vegetable origin, animal origin, and mineral origin. The picture you see, it is a cotton, and the man-made fibers, which is done by person, the man, may be categorized under regenerative, synthetic, and metallic. Regenerated one is, let us go for the vegetable fiber first. So under natural fibers, as I told you, there are three categories: vegetable, animal, and mineral. You can see now if you talk about the vegetable fibers, there are four different sources of vegetable fibers. One is seed fiber. Cotton is a seed fiber. The fibers are plung through the seeds. It's separated out by ginning and spun into yarn. Similarly, kapok. Kapok is very slippery. It does not have clinginess, so you can't make a yarn out of it. You can't spin a yarn. But it is very good for filling materials, even for pillows. Leaf fiber, we get a lot of fiber from the leaves of various trees like pineapple, sisal, manila hemp. Nowadays, a lot of manila hemp are being used, and the sisal also being used for different materials. Similarly, the bast fiber or the stem fiber, it is taken out from the outer surface of the plant, like jute, flax, hemp, banana, and ribbon. Banana in India, we are using a lot of banana fibers. You know, when you grow banana trees, it gives fruit only annually, once in its lifetime. Then it is cut and just thrown away. But now we are using those banana fibers for different materials. Nut fiber, this is coconut, the coir. We are using a lot of home furnishing out of coconut and the doormats and the other materials for the coconut fibers, nut fibers. Next, the animal origin. There are two. One is silk and there is the wool. Both are important. Silk is, in fact, there are four different types of silk are there. In India, all four are there. It is the only country in the world where all four kinds of silk are available. Mulberry is the most dominant or the extensively used. The name is Bombyx mori. Tropical tusser, there's a brownish color tusser, it's Anthria mylita. And the oak tusser is a whitish tusser, thinner than our tropical tusser, the Anthria prolei. And Eri is the only Ahimsa silk we call. And then Muga. Muga is the golden fiber, most costliest. It is only available in India, and that too in the northeastern part of our country, in Assam. So except mulberry, all are wild. Mulberry is cultivated in home. All other three are in the jungles or in the forest. That's we call it wild silk. Then to wool. Wool are the fibers from the animals. Like sheep, merino is the finest to merino. Then you have got the desi countries, different countries has got different breeds. India also has got different breeds. Goats. Goats are also a very good source of getting the wool. Pashmina is the finest. Merino has got about 30 microns in its diameter, whereas Pashmina is about 13 to 15 microns. The finest fiber we get from goat. Mohair, camel, alpaca, and llama also gives a lot of hair for getting the yarn and the fabric. Angora rabbit and the ear. So these are all the sources from animal kingdom getting the yarns, the fibers. The man-made, the people have started making the yarn from somewhere 1930, 1931, when viscose rayon was first invented. It is simply a regenerated, we call it a regenerated, because the wood pulp, we cut the trees and we get the wood pulp, we purify it, then we do shredding and we dissolve in carbon disulfide, then we coagulate with sulfuric acid, strong sulfuric acid, and stretch into a yarn. Similarly, other rayons, acetate rayon, cupramium rayon, bamboo, nowadays it's a very popular, bamboo is also cut and spun into yarn of this kind of, it's a regenerated, not the original bamboo, it's a regenerated bamboo. Then is synthetic yarn. We call it synthetic because it's raw material. In regenerated, it was raw material was natural, natural resources. But in synthetic, all are man-made, all are synthetic, all are not, nothing is natural there. It's all from petroleum products. Nylon came somewhere 1935-37, polyester in 1940-41, really acrylics, polyethylene, all those things are mostly are industrial use, but nylon, polyester and acrylics are extensively used in the textiles. Metallic yarn, we call it jerry, which is used mostly in the textiles, and then iron and steel for the industrial purposes. Jerry, we have got a long tradition and history in our Indian textiles. I'll discuss about jerry separately. And other fibers like glass and carbon, these are also for industrial purposes. So this is about the jerry. You know, now in the market, there are two types of jerry, pure and imitation. Pure is very less, very, very less, because it's very costly. The gold is very costly these days. And earlier days, it was gold jerry means it is gold. Gold were flattened, silver were flattened, it's called badla. But now it is not, no more in use. But traditionally, there's a core thread, there is a core thread either of cotton and left slide. You can see the cotton, traditional cotton, mulberry silk, viscose rayon. Out of this or polyester. Initial days it was only cotton or mulberry silk. That used to be the core yarn. The core yarn used to be and coiled with silver. Silver is made into a very thin sheet of thread and coiled over it. And then it is electroplated with gold solution. And that 1 kg of that yarn contains about somewhere 4 to 8 grams of gold. So that used to be the traditional pure jerry. Even today, as per demand or as per requirement, people are there to make such kind of jerry, pure jerry in the industry. Contemporary pure jerry, what they do? They have started using copper with silver. The base thread or the core thread remains the same, either cotton or mulberry or viscose rayon or polyester. They mix copper to some extent, maybe 20%, 30%, up to 60% with silver, make an alloy, then coil, and then electroplating with the gold. So this is about the pure jerry. Regarding imitation jerry, there is no gold at all. Sometime, very rare, in traditional, what we call half fine jerry in our southern parts of country, in Chennai, in Kanchipuram or other areas, we call half fine. There, we rarely use gold, that too in a very small quantity, maybe 1 gram or 1.5 gram per kilo of jerry. There, the core yarn remains the same. Here, copper is more, about 40, more than 40%, up to 80%, and silver is only just 20%. So that kind of jerry is also now in the market, that is traditionally being done. And at present, very recently, now they have started using nickel, zinc, and cadmium in place of gold. So there are no trace of gold at all. And copper, almost 80%. If you just rub in the touchstone, that you'll get a image of the brown color of the copper image. So that is a contemporary imitation jerry. Mostly they are using imitation jerry, traditional one, where there's a small quantity of gold. These are some of the images for the jerry manufacture. The left hand side, they are coiling the silver thread in the core yarn to get the bobbin with the silver thread. And then it is electroplated with gold solution. Then one, it is drawn from that solution. It is wind on a, it is reeled. Then it is dried in the air under shade. Then it is packed and sent to the market. Now you see the, I told you there were the fibers. Now you can compare the properties of the fibers. why it is required? Because the properties of fibers ultimately decides the property of the fabric. Its strength, its color, absorbability, its comfortness, its brave, everything depends on the fibers property. You can just see, I have taken mostly the natural fibers, except viscose is a regenerated yarn, because nowadays a lot of viscose are being used. And even jerry, they are putting the core yarn as viscose. The strongest is, sorry, the density of cotton is 1.54, whereas the muga is 1.80. So muga is the heaviest yarn among the natural fibers. And wool is the lightest fiber among the natural fibers. That to pashmina is very, very light. Tenacity, the strength, you can see, again, linen. Linen is the strongest fiber among the all natural fibers. That's why a lot of ropes earlier days used for the ships particularly used to be made out of linen. Even today also a lot of the flax and linen are being used for the ropes and other industrial purposes. Cotton has 3.4 grams per dress. Yeah. At the elongation means how much you can stretch before it breaks. That's called elongation. So it is again wool which really stretches more the most before it breaks. Cotton and linen has got very low elongation. It breaks fast. It does not extend too much. Moisture again, how much moisture it absorbs in the normal condition. Again, wool is 18%. And you won't believe, till 40%, if you get 40% of moisture in wool, it does not feel wet. It still feels dry. So that much of capacity of absorbency of wool is there. Cotton is 8. So this all depends how much the color it will absorb in substance processing or dyeing and printing. And then susceptible to insect and mildew. You know, you can see the wool is very much susceptible to insect and mildew. Whereas silverfish damages all products. When there is a humid, there is no air, silverfish damages. Mildew also occurs in all silks. But cotton and the vegetable fibers are quite strong enough that way. Acids, all viscose or the cotton or the linen, which are the cellulosic fibers, acid weakens them. So you cannot put acids on cotton or any other vegetable matters. But the animal fibers like mulberry, tussar, muga, eri, and wool, they are sufficiently strong enough to resist dilute acids. So in fact, sometimes dilute acid is used to finish the silk goods for scrooping. You know, you get a very harsh sound kind of thing is a scrooping. Similarly, alkali. Alkali, all cellulosic fibers like cotton, linen, and viscose, it resists alkali. In fact, moisturization is done with caustic soda in cotton. It's a good process for making cotton feel better. Take colors better. Whereas other animal fibers like mulberry, tussar, muga, eri, and wool are very much susceptible to acid. They dissolve the fiber. Then from the fiber we come to yarn. There are again two types of yarn. One is spun. Spun is made by twisting short staple of fibers. Small, it's small, maybe 1/2 inches to 4, 5, 6 inches. Then it is twisted either by hand, nowadays all of course in the machine, but again in India there is still a hand spinning process prevails. So it is spun into yarn and it has a very special character, a very woolly textures. You can feel the yarn and you can see the many fibers are coming out of the surface. Cotton is always spun, wool is always spun, pashmina, linen, airy silk and spun silk. Sometimes some other long strand fibers like silk, polyester, nylon are specifically they are cut into small staples and spun into yarn. And these yarns may be either single one thread or may be plied and twisted together to make it stronger or for a specific purpose. Then filamental yarn. Filamental yarn is, there is no long, the short staple is a long continuous strand. Silk, no? Silk cocoon. That silk worm secretes saliva kind of material, we call it sericene. about 1,000 meters long in the cocoon. Similarly, all those natural synthetic fibers are strong, are drawn and made into thread. These are all continuous fiber. These are filamental yarn. Again, this filamental yarn is also sometimes cut into short staple, as I told earlier, and made into spun yarn. This filamental yarn can be maybe monofilament, only one thread, maybe multifilament. There are many fine filaments taken together, make a thread. It may be single or it may be plied. For silk, it takes about 6 to 12 cocoons or silk threads to ply or to make one yarn. Now come to fabrics. Fabrics, again, I tell there are, to my mind, we can categorize into two different types. One, the simple structures. For the elementary fabrics, where there is only one series of warp and one series of weft, and they intersect with each other, they work with each other in a right angle, in right angle. You know, there is only one set of threads, vertical, which is called warp, and another set of set called weft, which is horizontal. These only two set of threads make the fabric, and it is called basic fabrics. And the weaves may be like plain weave, the figure is a plain weave. Then the reeve may be mat in twill, satin, textile, many. There are hundreds of such weaves available. Second one is compound structures. Compound structures are called pattern fabrics. There is a different series of warp or weft or both are inserted along with the base fabric to make the patterns, to make the designs, to make tapestry fabrics, make saris, all ornamented fabrics, that with compound textures. You can't get a pattern fabric with just one series of warp, one series of weft, unless you go for a different kind of weaves. What is plain weave? This is very elementary thing, but I feel I should explain this thing. Why it is important? It works only with two set of threads, one warp, one weft, and it takes only two threads. You can see in the diagram, the warp is black thread is vertical, and the white one is the horizontal, is the weft. So it's worked alternatively. Graphically, we show it one up, one down. So each thread interlaces with another alternately. That's why it is the strongest fiber among all the weaves. More than 80% of fabrics in the market, in the industry, are made of plain fabric or the plain weave. Next important is the twill weave. This is the most versatile weave. It requires minimum three ends and three peaks. Plain was only two, but here it is three, because if it is one up, one down, then it's plain. Here it is two up, then maybe one down, or two up, two down. So that kind of weaving is making twill weave, and you'll get an angular line, is a diagonal line across the fabric from one end to another. That says that this is a twill weave. Since it is a looser weave, as they say, float weave, it is relatively gives closer textures, heavy textures, and give a lot of ornamentations over it. And there are many varieties of twills, maybe zigzag, maybe herringbone. There are many such things. So it gives a beautiful textures over the fabric. Satin weave. This is another important weave in most of the fabrics, particularly in Banaras and other, they weave this fabric, this weave, because here it requires minimum four end and four peaks, but the beautiful satin comes only with five ends and five peaks, five end satin we call it. Here it only intersect or interlace once in a repeat. One thread intersects only once in a repeat. So other time it floats. So when it floats over the surface, you get a very smooth surface, either by warp, that is called satin, S-A-T-I-N, or by weft, which is called S-A-T-E-E-N. This is very versatile fabric when you make the brocade fabrics. I will show those pictures in subsequent slides. Now come the pattern texturing or the compound texturing. We call it, this is the most versatile designing style. In India, mostly for the saris in their borders, sari borders, we call it extra warp. We insert one extra series of threads. You can see it's the orange color. The black color is the plain weave for the ground or the base fabric, whereas the orange color is the extra thread making the design over the fabric without disturbing the basic fabric, it just simply goes up and down of its own without disturbing the base fabric. So if you take out that yarn, that extra yarn from the fabric will not distort. The fabric will remain still intact. So that's why you call it extra warp designing. The design is made in the warp. So it's called extra warp. And this technique gives faster production. You can weave very fast with this style of designing technique. Then extra weft, this is the reverse, extra weft. Here the designing is done by extra weft threads. There's a one series or two series of extra threads may be taken as per the design. Here the green color is the extra thread in the weft, and the black one is the ground weave of plain weave. Ground weave may be plain or twill, whatever may be. The extra threads just floats over it as per the design, as per the contour of the design, and come up on the surface of the fabric and gives the design. And this is controlled by the jacquard or the jala in a particular fashion. Again here, if you take that extra thread from the fabric will not really get distorted, it remains intact. But this technique is very slow, because you have to do every time by hand, and no machine can make this kind of fabric even today. I can show you some of the samples which are made in extra principles. Another one very intricate, and I think that this may be the oldest technique of making design. This is the tapestry design. Here there is no extra threads. Again, here there is no extra series of threads, neither in the warp nor in the weft. There is only one series of warp and one series of weft, but the wefts are not continuous. The wefts are small cut of lengths as per the design or as per the color. You can see the design is differentiated with the color. There is no extra thread here. It's a plain weave, and just see all the colors are separated only by the thread is returning from that place. It is just being manipulated within that area. No extra thread is inserted. It takes a lot of time. Or pashmina is a very good example of tapestry weaving, and it takes a lot of time to weave. Now some of the products I will come into now, some of the products where how it is made and what is the composition or the material involved in it, or how it has been made, what kind of fabric, what kind of material, what kind of weave. This is jamdani. Jamdani is not only limited to Bangladesh or Dhaka. You know, many weavers came to Bengal, the bordering states, and started weaving jamdanis there. From Bengal, in the coastal area, it has reached to Andhra Pradesh. And then with the migration of some weavers from Dhaka, it has started from Uttar Pradesh also. So in Bengal and Uttar Pradesh and Andhra Pradesh, these jamdani fabrics are woven. Uttar Pradesh is called Awadh Jamdani or the Tanda Jamdani. Bengal is Bengal Jamdani. Andhra Pradesh is Upada Jamdani. But all the three jamdani fabrics have got cotton in the warp and cotton in the weft as a base fabric. Design warp is also one series. It is only cotton. But design weft, there may be different varieties of cotton, different varieties of zari, different varieties of muga. Here in the picture you can see the small peg inside the flower is muga. The basic fabric white is cotton and cotton. The black is also cotton. And inside the black small dot which is made of muga. And this is an extra weft design. And the extra weft design's character is also plain. The extra weft designing also may be plain or twill, may be satin or any other weaves as per requirement. But in jamdani it is always plain. It's a Baluchari. It's a very prestigious product of Bengal. Baluchari used to be a village near Ganges in Murshidabad district, which is no more. Jiaganj is the place in there. But they don't make such kind of Baluchari these days. Vishnupur in Bengal, they make Baluchari's, but it has taken different form. People say that the weavers from either Gujarat or Banaras migrated to Murshidabad, and they have started weaving Baluchari sarees there. It is made of mulberry silk, and country mulberry silk of Bengal, the mulberry mystery varieties, local varieties. The cocoon is yellow color, but once you digam it and dye it, it takes a good color. Base weft also mulberry silk with zero twist, we call it part or tram silk. Design warp, only one series mulberry silk. Design weft also mulberry silk. There's no jerry at all here. But today there are many fabrics available in the name of Balchuri or Sarnachuri, they call, using a lot of jerrys. The specialty of this fabric is that there's a huge, huge pallo or the end, almost a meter, and in box pattern. It's a very intricate process they used to make by Jala. The design is extra weft, and the weave of the extra weft design either quill or satin. And one beautiful or one very different character of this Balchuri design is that normally outline of the design is dark colored. You go to Banaras, any other design, the dark color. Filling or the inside, the Meenakari is different, lighter color. But here, the outline is the white color. You can notice the design, the outline of the figure or outline of the motifs is the white, and the inside it is dark color. Banarasi Kimkhop. Kimkhop means it is so delicate, it is so decorated that even people cannot see in their dreams. It's called Kimkhop. A lot of jerry used, lot of jerry, gold and silver, Meenakari. Base warp is mulberry silk again. Base weft also mulberry silk. There is no extra design thread in the warp. And in the design thread, there is a silk and jerry. Jerry may be white or the silver, or it may be gold. The basic fabric or the base fabric either may be plain or it may be satin also. Design weave here again, it is extra weft. These threads are taken out one after another by hand. So it is non-continuous process. It is not a continuous thread going across the shade or across the width of the fabric. Each and every small flower or the booty, we call booty, is taken care of by the weaver. He weaves it separately, not all together at one go. That is very, very, that is a time-consuming process. It requires a lot of skill. This is Gaisar brocade or Tibetan brocade. Banaras is famous for this. For centuries they have been making. I think I met a person who is making, his fourth generation is making the same fabric and the same pattern and exporting to Tibet. These are mostly for the monasteries and the Buddhist religious purposes. It is a very heavy fabric, very, very heavy fabric. It is made of 8-thread satin base weave, made out of silk, mulberry silk. Design weave, lot of jerry, lot of both gold, silver, Meenakari. It is heavier than Kimkhop. And it is so compact fabric that people cannot make a fabric of 48 inches or 45 inches width. It requires a lot of strength. It's only 24 inches or 30 inches wide fabric made in a loom. Requires a lot of designing skill, lot of punch cards, maybe 10,000, 15,000, 20,000 cards are required. And very artistically it is woven. There shouldn't be any flaw or any mistakes. It is totally sewn on the surface of the fabric. And so it is defect. You can't put it on some serious matters. So this is a very, very traditional product of Banaras and for the Buddhist monasteries. This is a very old tidar or it's a konia. We call it, it is in the corner, we call it konia. And it is again made of mulberry silk. These small flowers or the booties again have been made by hand in a discontinuous process. You cannot throw the yarn from one side to another side. Each and everything is taken by hand and you have to weave it. The basic fabric is again plain. It is very much in practice today also, but the quality may be, or the designing may be, or the color may be different. But it is practice. But one thing I can tell you, that's a very old technique. They used to call it jala. Nowadays, jala is almost replaced by jacquard, which is faster. People are almost forgotten and they have introduced jacquard for using faster production. This tanchoi, it is again tradition of Gujarat, which has come to Gujarat, which has come from China to Gujarat. From Gujarat to Banaras. Tanchoi, they say there are three Choi brothers who taught this technique. So the fabric is called Tanchoi. It's a satin. Basic fabric is satin. And the warp is silk. Both warp. The only one set of in the warp, and the design also only one set. But only because of the colors, they have to put 3, 4, 5 colors as per the design. But they make in only one pick. All three colors or four colors make one pick and weave as a basic satin fabric. Asawali is a village, used to be a village, Asawal in Ahmedabad. Now this weaving has gone to Ridrol, about 80 kilometers from Ahmedabad, Gujarat. It's a very interesting thing. It has a lot of Minakari, very fine designing. You can see the Buddha, or you can see that the Kalga, they call. See the Minakari work there. How many colors they have put. Nowadays they've introduced jerry also. The basic fabric may be made of plain or satin. That is rare use, mostly plain. It is both by mulberry silk in the warp. The base fabric is mulberry silk. The only difference between the Banaras brocades and Asawali brocade is that in the weave of the extra weft is totally twill. There are separate heels or heels which controls that weave. And you can, throughout the fabric, you can see twill lines in the designs. Paithani, this is a tapestry, very, very time consuming factor and very much cumbersome to make a cotton as well as silk. Somebody again have started using cotton, but mostly it is in silk. And the designs have been taken from the paintings of Ajanta. The lotus is very famous, though they have got many other designs. And this is the very time consuming and very elaborate work being done here. So many colors they put. And the Paithan is a place in Aurangabad district of Maharashtra that it is still being used in a big way. Chanderi used to be only cotton and cotton. Base warp used to be cotton and the base warp used to be cotton. But now they have switched over to mulberry silk, raw form in the warp. But basic weft is still cotton. Design again, it is cotton and the border is of jerry. Design weft also cotton and jerry. This fabric. And the design of the extra warp and extra weft, either they put the twill design, satin design. Here you can, if you see the design, you can see a lot of twill lines on the in the flowers. So that is called binding. There's a system of making the fabric or the design floats into the in the fabric, making stronger enough. Kanchipuram, I think that is the oldest place of making silk sarees in India. Maybe 2nd BC. They started using silk in Kanchipuram. They give the very heavy textures on silk. It is thicker than Banaras texture or any other silk sarees in India. It's a more than 4 or 6 ply threads are taken to make the warp, both in the warp and the weft. They also use extra warp and extra weft with jerry. They also use mulberry silk as extra for designing. Their technique is different. They have got three subtle that the borders comes out very different from the body, very contrast. That is the beauty of this sarees. The three subtle, one subtle for the body and two subtles for different borders. This is the patula. Patula is from Patan. Patan is the place in Gujarat. And patula is a double ikat in silk. This is also very heavy texture. 8 ply or even 10 ply silks are taken. They make the thread such thick, then to do the processing of tying and dyeing. Basic fabric is plain, not like Cambodia. Cambodia, they make the ikat in twill weave. But here we make all ikat fabric, whether it's Orissa or Gujarat or Andhra Pradesh, it is all in twill weave. But it's a double ikat. You can see that both warp and weft have been tied and dyed. The yarn have been tied and dyed as per the design before putting it in the warp. From this place in Andhra Pradesh, they also make lot of silk sarees with heavy designing with jerry. It is not pure jerry, but mostly it is imitation jerry or half fine jerry. And there's a huge market in the south, and very numerous. They have also introduced nowadays the electric jacquard to get beautiful designs and bigger designs. Here again, the basic fabric is plain, over which they make a lot of designing with either silk or with jerry. Mysore, it was again in Madhya Pradesh, more than 200 years back, it has been started. Here the warp is silk, raw silk, where it is cotton. Fabric is a little thicker than the Rabchandri, but looks almost like Chandari. But here there is only extra web designing. There is no extra web designing as you have got in Chandari. It is only the extra warp designing the borders. The base fabrics may be either plain or the simple stripes. Kosha. Kosha, we get the references of Kosha. In Sanskrit, Kosha, the Kosha, is a tassar. It is from Madhya Pradesh, nowadays Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh. This is from Kosha, from Champa, Chhattisgarh. This is a tassar of our tropical tassar, brownish colored, real tassar. And the design work, you can see in the border, either it may be a cotton or it may be tassar. Basic fabric is plain, and the extra warp and extra weft designing have been put in the border as well as in the pallu. This is a special technique, you know, for weaving this fabric, the temple design. There's a three circle weaving here in Kosha. This is a bombay from Odisha. It's a very interesting, interestingly it has been found that such a beautiful fabric was made in cotton earlier. And it used to be used, consumed by the tribal ladies of that area. But during that festival of India, when it was done, we just dug out from that area and bring into limelight. Now a lot of bombay sarees are being made. But this particular sari have been made with cotton, coarse cotton, maybe 20s, 24s count cotton, base cotton of warp, base warp and base weft of cotton. Design also made is cotton. You can see that top of the left and right side of the border is a temple designed by hand, and the designing of the border as well as the pallu have been made with extra warp and extra weft with cotton. Pochampalli, it is also almost 200 years back they have started. Earlier it was in Chirala in Andhra Pradesh. Now they have made it in Pochampalli. Again, it's double liquor, both in cotton warp and weft. Basic fabric is plain. Sambalpuri, sometimes we call it Bichitrapuri. Here, this is a combination of double liquor as well as extra warp and extra weft. Basic fabric is cotton. Design warp and design weft is also cotton. Basic weave is cotton, plain. And the design weave with extra warp and extra weft, there is double liquor. You can see those squares. You know, this is the chess, you know, the pattern, which has been made in double liquor. So that's why you've got the pure white there, the pure black there. Mulgalpuru, again, Karnataka, is about 300 kilometers away from Bangalore. So it's with a lot of jerry work. And this particular motif called Danda Garunda, the two-headed birds, is very famous. It was a symbol of a dynasty. They make a lot of sarees with this in different form, in different shapes, but it is made in silk weft and three in the extra wall. Masru, it is cut by silk, mulberry in the warp, because it used to be only silk and silk, but particular community wanted silks touch their skin. So cotton was introduced. So it is cotton, silk by cotton. There's no extra threads. The basic weave is satin, S-A-T-I-N, warp satin. And the design is either twill or small tiny float. Sometimes even e-cups are also introduced. Again, this is also again a simpler version of brocade. Brocade used to be made of silk. They have made it costly fabric in earlier it used to be silk, now they are making cotton, warp and weft. Base fabric is twill cotton, but the weave is twill, and designing is by extra weft with cotton, or sometimes they make it jerry also. Weave is twill or satin. Here, the beauty is that sometimes they go almost 5, 6, or 8 colors as mina with this fabric. These are the backstab loom products of northeastern states. You know, northeastern states backstab looms. All each and every lady, they know how to weave fabric. So these are the backstab looms for their own consumptions. They make mekhla, chadar, risha, pasra, they call it locally. and they make their own garments and the dresses out of the fabric. They make it around black sheblum and all of cotton. Pashmina, this is the most costliest fabric in the country. You can see the weaver, how he is making one by one the small kani, or that's what you call it, kani shawl. The small, no, that the bamboo is called tili. In Banaras they call it tili, the small sticks wrapped with the colored threads. So each thread is taken one by one to make one pick. It takes almost 15 to 20 minutes sometimes to make insert one pick. It takes sometimes to make one shawl. The basic fabric weave is twill and the yarn is pashmina. Sometimes it is handspun. That fine handspun pashmina is still available in our country. Kullu or kinori shawl. This is again the tapestry weave which you saw in the Paithani, the same technique, but it's made in wool in our Himalayan areas in Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. Thank you so much. I think I'm almost done. I will take some questions from you. And I wish you a happy National Handloom Day, because as I told you initially, we are celebrating the Handloom Day today just to give recognition and respect to our handloom weavers who are keeping our tradition alive in the country and in the nation and in the globe. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Paul. Thank you so much for reminding us that today was the National Handloom Day. I think most of us, at least I didn't know. So I think it was a very nice coincidence. I also want to add that today was the 25th lecture in our lecture series. So it's a silver jubilee of sorts for us also. Thank you all for supporting us and to continue this.
Oh, that's really great.
So nice coincidence. So we'll start with the questions. The first question was a request. If you could put the animal sources of, the fibers, if you could just show that slide again.
Yeah.
That very quickly and
okay.
Missed something. So they said if that could be.
Okay. Okay.
And discuss. Was first request was that.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anjali, do you have any question regarding this slide, or you just want to have a look at the content on that slide?
I think I just want to have a look. Also, wanted to check if, like I know in Kashmir, they have bred local sheep with the New Zealand to produce local Kashmir merino. So.
Okay.
That's the Kashmir Merino, right? So, sir, is there any other place where Merino wool is produced?
In fact, Raymond started doing it, but they brought some Australian Merino. They started it, but it was not successful. No more Merino is being made by them. Okay. Now the Merino is being imported either from New Zealand or Australia. And being blended with the local wool.
Okay. So this is, I think, cross-breeding of sheep that they do in Kashmir with, Australian Merino. That's how they get the local Merino, which is fairly good. So, other than that, then there wouldn't be any other source, right?
No. Yeah. In fact, mostly it has come from the Ladakh areas. No, the Leh and Ladakh.
Yes.
More than 14,000 feet above, those pashmina boats, Chengda, they call it Chengda. Locally they call it Chengda. So even there is a dehairing plant established by the government of India a few years back. Dehairing plant of those pashmina boats in Ladakh.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome. Next question is, I think it was mentioned, but again, is cotton, viscose and polyester used as the core for wrapping metallic strips?
Yeah.
It is used for as a core for wrapping?
Yeah, either cotton. It means maybe either cotton or silk or viscose. And nowadays it is polyester also.
Okay.
The core yarn will be only one, not all. There are the four different categories of yarn. They are used as a core yarn. Or which it is coiled.
But sir, if I may ask, there's also another, they have a Lurex wrapping these days. So even the zari is not necessarily metallic, but it's very Lurex.
Yes. You are very correct. So we don't call it really technically it's a zari. It is simply aluminium foil or the polyester film with a metallic coat, the Lurex. Sometimes they call it powdered zari. So it does not really fall under. This is a simple Lurex or the artificial fiber. It doesn't come under the zari. They just maybe imitationally they cheaply they call it zari just to mislead the customers. But it's not.
So, sir, in today's context, when they say pure zari, what exactly should one look for or expect?
You see, there are two or three rather. I can tell you, if you forget about Surat, Surat is a huge market for zari manufacturing. There's an industry there. There's a GI for Surat zari.
Yes.
And when we call it pure zari, it should not be. There will be, of course, alloy, the copper and silver. Copper should not be more than 40%. 40, okay. 60, 40 copper, 60 silver. That alloy, coiling, and then the gold should not be less than 2 grams per kg, 2 to 7 grams.
That is.
So if it is less than 2 grams, then it is a half fine jewelry. We can't, and they, in that case, they don't give that much of silver. They just give copper that time. They increase the copper because there is no point of increasing the silver and putting less gold. If you are putting more silver, means you have to put more gold. Then only you get the money or the value.
Okay.
So if you want to have a very good jewelry or the called pure jewelry, the jewelry should not be less than 40 grams of should be less than 40 grams of copper. It should have at least 60 grams of silver, and 3 grams of gold per kilo of the jewelry yarn. People are there to make it. They are making it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Next question is. How can we differentiate between Banarasi brocade and brocades in other parts of India?
Yeah, Banarasi brocade, in fact, you know, brocading means is a transposing or putting design on it. That's called brocading. Banarasi brocade has got a different varieties of weaves. And the texture is not that important for the Banarasi man. Their designing is more important. If you see any Banarasi fabric, they are designing skill, they are designing literature or the patterning is much, much intricate mostly with kadhuma. You know, they call it not a continuous working on it. But in other areas, you will see that the brocading is by throwing the sartle, I mean, from one to another end. So you can get even the floats below that, which either may be cut or may be left like that. But that's also called, they're called it brocading. And there may be long floats. I mean, Banarasi is also there, but they don't call it brocade, they call it cut work.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
See, Asavali brocade, say for example, Asavali brocade, as I told you, Asavali is also brocade. In fact, the Banarasi brocade came from Gujarat only. Asavali brocade has got the weaving in a twill diagonal line binding. But in Banarasi, you go on there. Banarasi is all all are isolated. All small motifs are isolated. The motif has got different leaves. The different leaves may be having different weaves. But if it is Asavali, all leaves, all flowers, all petals will be the same twill line across. So that is the basic difference for the brocades of Banaras and other areas.
Thank you. Somebody has observed that the Asavali is from the Asaval family and they still continue the tradition. So it's nice to know. The next question is, do we have zari in Patola? Is there any zari in Patola? Any cases of zari in Patola?
Orders, small, maybe half an inch.
Okay.
Yeah, there is. But it's pure jewelry. They use pure jewelry because if they do not use pure jewelry, the jerry will not behave. They do a lot of processing while weaving also. Their loom is quite we.
Okay. So there is zari in patola.
Go to pattern and see the loom patola. The loom is angular, and the people do not sit; they stand and weave. But Surendranagar patola is different. Surendranagar patola is the very recent one. 50 years back they started. There is a normal loom, but patola loom is different.
Okay. Sir, your voice is breaking.
You can't maintain that. So they will. Otherwise, it will break. If it is brittle, it will break.
Okay.
Pure jerry is softer. In compared to the imitation jerry, pure jerry is softer. It is soft to touch. Okay. And even when you use the cotton as a core.
So next question is, can you differentiate between, how do you differentiate between Sambalpuri and Odia Banda?
Sambalpuri is essentially double ikat. Nowadays they are making in silk, but it used to be only with cotton, and there will be the extra warp and extra wave designing with the Rudraksh motif, or even ducks, or even fish. But Bandha is totally a tie and dye, mostly done in Nuapatna area. And in fact, the tradition says that Bandha warp used to be made for offering to the Lord Jagannath. That was the temple. Temple fabric. Then it has come to the sarees or other material. This is the bandha. Bandha is the generic term for tie and dye. Bandha.
Now, next question is, what is the nature of the tant saree in Bengal? We've touched Jamdini, Baluchari, but the third variety, tant sarees in Bengal, if you could describe the nature.
It is Taat Sari, Taat, no? It is called Taat Sari, because I am from Bengal.
I'm sorry.
So I used to weave such sari in my childhood or young, when I was in the village. It is a Taat Sari. Since it is made in, Taat means loom, hand loom. And Taat Sari has a speciality that sari used to be starched, putting size or the starch on the loom itself. So you get a very crispy look. You have a very beautiful look, crispy look, and all threads are putting in their places, not here and there, in a very staged condition. And the starch also used to be the, what is called dhanka lawa. Dhanka lawa means the parched paddy, roasted paddy. जो हम 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 जिसको हम जो offer करते दीपावली के समय. The white one, you remember the puffed the paddy?
Yeah, perfect.
So that is the source of the starch. We used to just soak in water and then put a small paste and put on the fabric by hand. And that used to give you the taat finish. But nowadays, what they do, because of time or simplification of the process, they take out the fabric and do this like charak or the polish in the outside the loom. They do it now. But originally it was taat sari, which was polished on the loom itself, and it has a very crispy look, and that starch used to stay on the loom on the fabric even after 3, 4, or 5 wash. That used to be called Bengal taat sari and the cotton.
Yes, quite a challenge to wear. The next is more information about Valkalam sarees. If you can share the structure of a Valkalam sari.
Valkalam.
My pronunciation may be wrong. Monisha, can you please come in? Valkalam.
Yeah. Hello. It's Valkalam sarees, and we had read in our long time back. I had read about it, and they are also from Banaras. But nowadays, you don't tend to see these sarees. And I have one sari of Valkalam, but it is like very heavy. It's very heavy to wear. So I wanted to just know the technique, whether it is still going on or they have, discontinued having Valkalam saris now. So that's the reason.
I have no idea about Valkalam in Banaras, because Banaras, I have no idea. Do you have any sample with you?
Currently, I don't have it with me. Actually, it is in my home in India. But I do have one sari of Valkalam.
I think the request was if you could share your email ID with them.
Yeah. So yes, you can send the emails. Yes.
Email ID, they'll
yes, all, please.
I'll do that.
Yes, sure.
Just go on.
Because the heaviest fabric I know in Banaras is the Gaisar brocade or Thanga, because they call it the Tibetan brocade. They're the heaviest brocade they make.
So, thank you, Manisha. Thank you, sir. The next question is about Kota Doria. The structure of Kota Doria. Did you?
Yes. No, I didn't mention, but I know because I was in Jaipur for long and I did a cluster development activities in Kota. Actually, the Kota Doria is the fabric made in Kaithun. Kaithun is the village about 15 kilometers from Kota. There are other areas also like Mangrol in Bara district, they make also Kota Doria. In fact, it was not in Rajasthan. Initially, it was not the Kota Doria which you see today. Earlier, it was only Doria. Make out of cotton, but the king of Rajasthan, they migrated, they took some weaver from Mysore to Kaithun to Kota, and they started using silk and in a very particular fashion. That's why Kota Doria is also sometimes called Masuriya silk, since it has come from Mysore, they call it Masuriya silk. The yarns are taken in a very particular fashion, they call it khat. The checks are called khat. You know, there are 14 threads of silk and cotton. They are taken in a particular fashion, 2-1, 2-1, 4, like that. Small checks are made. Both way, warp wave, in a similar fashion they make it. And they make in a... perfect check, very compact check.
Okay.
So the chicks does not, the yarn does not get distorted, doesn't go out. That khat is very important for Kota Doria. And you won't believe there are more than 300 khats, 300 to 400 khats, very fine sari they make across the week.
Okay. So volume.
Hundreds, very fine.
Okay.
They are using coarser yarn, they are using coarser silk, they are using thicker yarn, they are using thicker fabric, simpler thing. They are not using those earlier textures no more. And one beautiful thing was the earlier days. Use fake jerry or imitation jerry or even neem jerry. They used to always use pure jerry. Even today also they do not allow neem jerry. Otherwise, they will boycott the weaver who are using those series now.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, if you could repeat the proportion of copper to silver in half fine zari sari, what is the proportion of copper to silver?
This one?
Half fine zari sari.
Silk? Half fine, yeah. Half fine zari sari. Half fine, I told you, this imitation zari.
Silver?
Yeah, half fine jelly copper, maybe just 80 grams copper or 20 grams silver. That is the maximum. Then when you come to better quality, it comes up to 40 grams silver, 60 grams copper. And then maybe 1 gram, one half gram of gold. Then if it is half fine with gold, they call it pure gold. They don't say call it half fine in that case. But if it is half fine, if you go back, if it is half fine, there is no trace of gold.
Okay.
You see, you can get the contemporary imitation jewelry. You can see the extreme right hand. You can get nickel, you can get zinc, you can get cadmium. But because cadmium does not give, yeah, these are the metals they are using now. Electroplating with such things.
Okay. Thank you. Next question is Tant, same as Tangil. T-A-N-G-I-L-E. Is that both?
No, Tangil. Yeah, Tangail is different. Tangail again is the name of the village.
Okay.
Now it is in Bangladesh.
Okay.
Tangail sari has got a taat finish. Very true.
Okay.
Tangail sari has got a taat finish. Santipuri has got a taat finish. Dhaniya Khali has got a taat finish. These are all the cotton saris of Bengal, traditional saris, which has got taat finish.
Thank you. The next question is there a technique similar to the Korvai technique of Kanchipuram used elsewhere in the country?
There are many. You see, I told you Chhattisgarh, the Champa, they make the temple design, they call Karvat Kati, the sawtooth, the zigzag or some triangle. That is also by three shuttle. Okay, even in Tamil Nadu, the Salem dhotis, that is the three shuttle. In Odisha, the Bompui sari, I saw you the border, that is the three shuttle. Bengal, they have got a kadiyal, which is used in the puja. During puja period, you can see all the red and white sari, red border and white sari. We often use in that during Durga Puja. That is called kadiyal. That's all three shuttle.
Okay.
Even the shuttling, Rajasthan, they got a coarsest pattus, woolen pattus. There also you get the solid red border.
Okay.
So it is many states. It is many states, not only in Kanchipuram.
I think any more questions? I don't see any in the chat box. Although, Mr. Paul, there was a small comment, I think more of a thing that the All India Handloom Board has been scraped. It doesn't exist. People are asking your views on it on this Handloom Day. I think it's something not related. But since you are there, I think it's a relevant. I think that people are saying maybe if this question can be asked and you could share your opinion. Given this, I think, talk and looking at the handlooms and everything, why is the All India?
I mean, in fact, not only this, I got some other points also. I'd like to brought to the notice of the common man and the handloom connoisseurs. See, suddenly it is a very much disappointing and unfortunate. That was the only body which used to give suggestions to the government for the development of the sector. They have given the reason that minimum government, maximum governance. But it is simply a committee, it's a board. There is no official bearers. We make only once or twice a meeting, that's all. And they give the suggestions, and the government take into consideration all those things as per their requirement. So these things can be done even now, this virtual as we are doing now. No, there is no extra cost involved in it. So I do not know why it's been abolished. It should have been just unfortunate. Rather, they could, if it is a bigger one, they could have making a smaller one, not so many people, very selectively, who are really the experts on those things. But it is really unfortunate. It should not have been happening. And when you say this handloom is next to agriculture, we have got 3.5 million people engaged in it. It's a rural sector. We must promote it. It's handloom day. Then it is really not in the line of the spirit we see the government.
Thank you so much. I think thank you so much for this wonderful lecture. I think if there are more suggestions and topics, we'll definitely try to have you again. Maybe talk
sure.
Because I think there's you as a repository of knowledge that you possess that people really would want to get their hands on. So the email ID is there for everyone. So please, they can contact you through the email ID. Thank you so much, Mr.
Sure.
It's a pleasure interacting with you and this lecture. Thank you everyone for joining us. And the next, this marks the end of the textile series, but we are hoping to continue and bring some more textile related textile conservation lectures in the future. Thank you all for supporting us and these 9 lectures that we had. I think it was thanks to all you speakers and your support. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Paul.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Very grateful to you. Grateful to you and Intact.
Also, the pleasure was all entirely ours, please. The pleasure was ours. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you.